life.
Welcome, you are watching the Smithsonian Latino Center Mobile Broadcasting here in Santa Fe, Nuevo Mexico. We are collaborating with Culture Connects Santa Fe, part of the Santa Fe Arts Commission. I am Dr. Xochitl Chavez, and it's an honor to be here with artist Nico Salazar in the museum that has recently opened up in Nuevo. Nico, could you tell us a little bit about yourself and where you're from and the location that we're in?
Yeah, my name is Nico Salazar. I was born and raised in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And right now we're in Yowulf. It's an art complex here in Santa Fe, New Mexico. There's over 70 different rooms to explore. It's kind of like a giant fun house. And behind me is my work in my room that I was commissioned to do. And pretty much I covered the whole room in original and pop art characters, all done in Sharpie. And it's been awesome.
Can you tell me a little bit about your cultural background? And we were talking a few moments ago that your family actually is from Pecos.
Yeah, my family's from Pecos, New Mexico. And my grandmother, she lived a very rural life in Pecos. And that entailed using a wood stove, having horses, picking herbs from the river. And her ghost stories and folk tales is what really inspired me and my original characters. She always would talk about duendes or marijuana and just different folk tales of the area and ghost stories, stories about witches. And I kind of just like to make my own style, my own cartoon style of her stories.
So part of this collaboration that we've been doing is what objects do we hold and what kind of stories and memories do they create? But for you, you're actually the one that holds the pen in your hand that helps to create these types of images and actually utilizing it and making art. Could you tell us a little bit more about what were those first images? How did you draw them? How did you envision them? What was the medium that you used to draw?
Definitely. The medium I used was all done in a marker. I chose marker because I feel like just growing up without a lot of resources, I chose the one thing that I was able to use the most growing up. I didn't always have fancy markers or fancy pencils, so I kind of just used the Sharpie and paint markers to illustrate all this behind me. And I just kind of like feel like utilizing what you using markers and just like using tools from like that aren't expensive to make something really crazy, because it's really all about your imagination and your creativity rather than material objects.
Okay, so definitely utilizing the resources that you have available to you, right?
Yeah.
In different economic circumstances. So as you were saying, and I see right here with your hand, you have some beautiful art. Could you tell us a little bit of what you have on your arm and how does that speak to maybe identity for you?
Sure, these are Loteria cards and they're Loteria cards of Mexican bingo. They each have a different meaning to me personally, but the mermaid was because my dad was in the Navy, and El Corazón is because the heart and compassion is supposed to be the key to understanding all people. The rose is for rugged beauty, like I was saying before. Just kind of not having a whole lot of beauty, just something beautiful out of this way. El Sol is, I did it as our Zia symbol, because I was born and raised in Santa Fe. El Nopal, the cactus, that's another form of rugged beauty. It's really tough on the outside, but it also provides water and it's a beautiful local plant. And then La Luna is the moon. And the moon represents emotion, but it also represents our Lady of Guadalupe, which is my patron saint, the one that I pray to, or the one that looks after me. And yeah, these are all just Loteria cards. I'm hoping to expand them more as I go on more adventures.
Could you tell us a little bit about how did this process begin? Who are we looking at? How long did it take?
Yeah, this process began. I was able to get into this room in particular in December, the end of December. So this full room took me 6 weeks to complete. I was doing 14-hour days. The Meow Wolf project in a whole probably was over 14 months of planning and putting it all together. But I actually did this room all in 6 weeks. And it was really intense. I did the ceiling, but I chose to not have any lights or anything flashy. I just kind of wanted to show that, you know, you could do a lot with just one thing, like the marker, the Sharpie.
It's just the black Sharpie. That's all you use.
Yeah, just the black Sharpie.
And you were saying something that you had to, how did you get the top? Is this, was this already done on like a paper and then it was up, or you actually are on the wall?
I actually was on the wall. I was upside down on a scaffold, so I did a little ceiling laying down. I was about like a, maybe like a couple inches from the ceiling. So it was really intense. My arm got tired all the time, but it's kind of like, it was worth it, because I was just like, this will take me to the next level. If I can finish this, then I can do something crazier and bigger.
Tell me a little bit about what does it mean for you to have your art featured in a permanent location versus many times when we think about pop art or in urban spaces, those might, you know, run the risk of only being there temporarily. Can you tell us a little bit about that dichotomy of temporary and versus a permanent space?
Yeah, I think whenever I do street art, it's always temporary, and I think that is really cool because it adds a little bit of exclusivity, or maybe you might only be able to see it at a certain time. But with this project, it's able to be here permanently, and you know, my niece can see it when she's older, and like just people can come check it out. And yeah, it's a permanent space. It's different, a lot different than the art in Santa Fe, and I think that's cool just to show kids and just other people that Santa Fe is full of all kinds of art, not just necessarily Southwestern, which is really beautiful. But yeah, I wanted to bring the street style to the Santa Fe art world.
Yeah, definitely showing different genres and venues or and inspirations. Are there any pieces in here that maybe speak to you in a different way? Like, what kind of story, if you're able to say there's a part in this drawing, like, is there anyone that has a story for you? Or how do you bring them together?
Yeah, I mean, this whole room, I like to call, it's kind of like a planet Earth, and how it's so crowded, but there's so many different people. I would say a good story for me is my grandma back in Pecos. Her dad used to herd sheep, and two sheep went missing. So he went and chased the sheep, and behind a rock, there were two old ladies laughing at him. And pretty much the sheep were witches or wiccas, and they turned into, I guess they were sheep the whole time because they never came back. And so my grandpa, my great-grandpa, always said to never go by this one rock. So there's like a bunch of wiccas like in the wall. That story was always really weird because I always just thought, like, I don't know, just the mystery of it. And my family has a ranch back home. It's called Pinot Royale, and that's where they all were born on the ranch. And so when you go back there, it's like very rural and different. And it's really nice because, you know, growing up in the city, I never got to experience the rural lifestyle. So when we go out there, it's like you always hear weird sounds at night, and you never know if you're in a rock that the robots were behind. So I would say there's lots of those. There's also lots of food in here. I feel like food is a huge part of just like, you know, my grandparents and my family. So you'll see there's tacos, red chili, there's horchata, churros, like all kinds of my favorite food, basically. And yeah, but other than that, sometimes the characters are just really weird aliens. I think being from New Mexico, there's Roswell down south, so I think that's always been an influence to me.
So folk tales have definitely influenced some of your earlier forms of work, and even to today. Great. Well, do you have any last comments that you'd like to share with our public, or even for youth, in terms of inspiration about artwork and continuing to strive in what they might dream?
Totally. I just want to tell everyone that wants to be an artist or wants to make it out there to always believe in yourself. Because there's so many times where I felt like I wanted to give up, or maybe I'm like, I don't have my money to get something done. You can always get it done as long as you believe in yourself. I used to clean houses when I was 16, and now I'm able to do what I love because I never gave up on it. And I just think if you work hard and believe in yourself, and no matter what anyone tells you, you'll be able to live your dreams. Yeah, thank you guys so much.
Thank you so very much, Nico. I appreciate it. For allowing us into your room, the fact that at this space there is a room by Nico Salazar, a native of Santa Fe, New Mexico, and showing your inspiration. So once again, thank you very much. Smithsonian Latino Center Mobile Broadcasting here desde Santa Fe, Nuevo Mexico, and Mobile Contemporary Museum. I am Dr. Xochitl Chavez. Continue to watch us on Ustream, Smithsonian Latino.